My name is Adam Ward. I'm Director of Studies of the ISS, and I'm going to be chairing this event on Russia, the Middle East, and the geopolitical implications of Trump. The title packs a lot in, and this has, of course, been a very busy year. And in that year, one of the most striking geopolitical developments has, of course, been Russia's intervention in the Syrian conflict. I think that's had a decisive influence on the shape and the likely outcome of that dispute. I think it has demonstrated Russia's determination to assert its interest, its capacity to project military force internationally, and its involvement now in two conflicts, effectively, in two strategically important regions, Europe and the Middle East. And, of course, the Middle East has now had to come to terms with a Russia that is, again, a rather large player in the region, a player beyond simply the considerations concerning the Iran nuclear program, where it did have a very important voice. And if that wasn't complicated enough, we now have to pour on that concoction, as it were, the additional factor of Trump. Somebody whose statements indicate a basic position of being relaxed about the preservation of the Assad regime, somebody who has identified Russia as an important partner in the effort of defeating ISIS, and so on. So as to the directions in which the situation will flow, it's not clear to me, but luckily we have two people on hand who can give us a better guide to that than I can. And both of them are members of the ISS International Advisory Board, the Council, which yesterday had its annual meeting to help the Institute consider what issues it should be focusing on and to provide, if I can put it this way, a little bit of adult supervision to us to make sure that we're not going off in any stray directions and to suggest some new ones to us as well. And they're going to be taking 10 minutes each to address us, and then we'll have some Q&A, and this session will be on the record. The first to speak will be Dr. Igor Jurgens, who's chairman of the management board of the Institute of Contemporary Development in Moscow. The description is rather modest, that it's a body that facilitates relations between Russian policymakers and the country's expert community, but it's recognized as being very much a source of original thinking about international and domestic challenges in its own right. And Amos Yadlin is executive director of the Institute for National Security Studies, which is recognized as the top think tank in its field in Israel. And he's been doing that since 2011. And prior to that, he had a very distinguished career of military service, including as chief of intelligence of the of defense intelligence of the IDF for about 4 years or so. So Igor, can we hand it to you first to put the issues perhaps somewhat into a historical perspective, perhaps, and to cast things forward, and then Amos to maybe take things up from the perspective of how the Middle East is reacting to these developments. Igor.
I thank you very much. It's a great pleasure and honor to be here. And in 10 minutes, it's almost impossible to wrap it up because it's a wealth of knowledge, it's a wealth of history, it's enormous, enormously broad issue. But let me start with a few historical remarks. Russian Empire involvement in the Middle East, of course, mainly started with our conflicts with Turkey. And our conflicts and wars with Turkey took us 351 years. About 40 conflicts altogether. Some of them are big wars. 69 years out of 351, there were very serious military showdown between Russia and Turkey. And Russia's ultimate goal was to get to the Straits, Bosphorus and Dardanelles, and then to Mediterranean in order to trade, in order to have access to the big world, because we were considered at that period almost a landlocked country. The Soviet Union carried on in many instances. That was different. That was not how should I say, the geographical, geopolitical design, but it was a class struggle continued in the Middle East. First, Mr. Stalin was enticed in the question of creating an Israel as a socialist state. Then he felt deceived. There was a very exotic project of creating Israel or Jewish state in Crimea, which is now being disputed. That didn't come through. Because of that, a lot of Zionist activists in the Soviet Union were killed, shot, imprisoned. But that was a real project, to build up a socialist state in Crimea, building up kibbutz there, giving them land and creating a forward-looking Jewish state on the territory of the socialist proletarian paradise of the Soviet Union. That was a real thing. Ended up badly, but then when the United Nations negotiated the creation of Israel, Stalin and the Soviet Union were the first one to support the idea, undersigned it, and a lot of institutions of Israel, and probably my friend will confirm, starting from Histadrut, which are the trade unions, and ending up by many others, is just a replica of the Soviet institutions, because a lot of Russian Jews went to Israel to build up a new state. Apart from this, of course, we immediately, as soon as first and second wars in the Middle East ended up badly for our Arab allies, and that was already classical class struggle kind of a thing, Soviet Union massively supported Egypt, Syria, then Palestinians, and so on and so forth. So our involvement there was very confrontational with the West in general, and with Israel at that time. When Gorbachev came to power, and after the first visit of Shimon Peres, first unofficial, I participated in that one, and then official ones, we mend swords, we became allies, almost strategic allies, we led a lot of Jewish people from Russia to go to Israel and to become a loyal citizen of this country. There are a wealth of contacts between the two countries. But again, geostrategic interests became different. Soviet Union could afford a lot in its showdown with the United States. Russia could not. So we almost retreated from all of our old friends and all of that stuff, with the exclusion of the family of Assad, with whom our former Prime Minister and Minister of Foreign Affairs, Mr. Primakov, kept the personal ties for a long, long time. Some people hinted at the intelligence connections, agent kind of a connections. Then same Mr. Primakov, who was the academician at the same time, he taught people from, including Abbas. Abbas, I think, made his doctorate under the tutelage of Mr. Primakov. So historically, though, we couldn't afford much of the escapades in the Middle East. We kept very keen contact and political ties and affinities. Mr. Putin balanced it somewhat. There is no anti-Semitism in him whatsoever. Lots of his friends and connections and business contacts are Jews, and we all know that any expression of anti-Semitism is being killed by him in the bud, and he's a great supporter of Israel. From this point of view, it's kosher, if I can use it this way, this term. But for the geostrategical situation of Russia, as soon as it became assertive, as soon as it accumulated some wealth, oil wealth, military wealth, etc., etc., we started playing a certain role in the Middle East for the sake of our interests. And that brings me to the third part of my little introduction, that's Syrian case. I would like to remind, we were never present militarily. in the Middle East after the collapse of the Soviet Union. We were never present in terms of massive economic aid or something like that. We kept a little trickle of students coming to the University of Friendship of in Moscow, but that was not a big deal. But when the situation around Syria became as acute as it became, for 2.5 to 3 years of the first stage of that Syrian, call it uprising, call it a civil war, call it whatever, Soviet Union was sort of on you know, just watching. Then, because of the Ukrainian situation, and because Putin felt offended by the West, thrown out of G8 and all of that stuff, he adroitly used the situation with the flop of Obama on the red lines issue, if you remember. When Obama said, well, chemical weapon would be the red line, and then we go and massively solve the problem, and he didn't. Then, on the third already, or even fourth year of the conflict, Mr. Putin starts showing some signs of, oh, I can be helpful. And at that time, I personally, and I'm not the Oriental Studies specialist, but at that moment, it was meant by Kremlin as one of these services to the West and to Obama personally, in exchange for which Mr. Putin was expecting the comeback to G8, the respect, and all of that stuff. So he managed to get in. He did this proposal on the elimination of chemical weapons. We did it together with the United States. Russians were taking the weapons out. United States were destroying it out in the sea and all of that stuff. And that was a successful project. But then something went sour. Obama didn't want Putin to use it as a Trump, excuse my neological language, to get back to the world politics. And he kept it in distance. Okay, you did it on a chemical? Get this asset out of the question at all. That's too much for the pride of Mr. Putin to digest. You said, get my ally out? No way, I will show you what I can do. And then the whole hell broke loose and they started building up. And in a very efficient, from the military point of view, Russians managed to build up in Tartus and other areas of Syria, big, serious, military contingent, firstly and foremost, of course, air base and air force, but also to show off, they put this caliber new missiles with high precision, potentially could be, by the way, be nuclear, but at the moment it's not. And the beauty of those caliber is that you put it on a boat, like a pleasure boat, 5 meters long, and it can strike up to 3,000 kilometers with a very high precision. And that was, from my point of view, a sign of not only the big presence in Syria with show of force, but also a sign to the United States of America that you are not immune from our first strike, even in the military installations from the boats which you will never trace in the big ocean, because you put it on the tanker, you put it on the pleasure boat, you put it on passenger boat, and you will be struck anyway. So that was a show of force when personal relations between Obama and Putin and relations between the United States and Russia became the Cold War-ish kind of. So what's the purpose of Russian diplomacy at the moment? I think still the same. On the one hand, now for the face-saving operation, they have to safeguard some kind of a transitional role of Assad in negotiations with the opposition and those who are against him, and that's 2/3 of both population and territory of Syria. But on the other hand, bringing Russia back on the top table. And if that can be done through new cause in personal relations with Trump, again, victory of Vladimir Putin. If that cannot be done, and we will see it in a couple of days' time, if it's Giuliani as the Secretary of State, I doubt that very much. If someone who would be palatable for Russians, then Minister of Foreign Affairs Lavrov will first try to cozy up with Kerry until the 20th of January 2017, and then they will probably will try to strike a deal saying that, okay, Trump and Putin, ceasefire, peaceful negotiations, everybody on the table, Assad is on the table for some kind of a time, Kurds on the table, Sunni, Shia, and we put the world to order. That's the ultimate objective. There are too many loopholes and traps on that way, but I think that's what the Russian side has in its mind at the moment. I know Adam how strict and disciplined he is. And since I took my 10 minutes, I'm ready to be already reprimanded. Okay.
Thank you very much for that and for the presentation. I must over to you.
Thank you, Adam. Thank you for inviting me. And Igor, thank you for being here with me. Five observations from Jerusalem. What is the Russian motivation to intervention in Syria? The conventional wisdom is saying we want to save Assad. But I think it's much deeper than that. Maybe saving Assad is low on the list. First, Russia wants to be again a global player. And they have found that the Middle East is close enough on one hand. They are projecting power on the other hand, which is superpower. This is something the superpowers do, project power. And they are playing the global game. And the Middle East is only one card. I will not be surprised if after Trump will be in the White House, a global deal will be struck. So I don't know what the Americans will ask, what the Russians will offer, but Syria is only a card on the global aspiration of Russia to become again a superpower. Second, Russia wants to show the world that unlike the US, they are loyal to their allies. In the Middle East, people are criticizing the Obama administration of basically not keeping good relation with their allies. Mubarak was thrown under the bus. The Saudis, the Israelis were faced with the deal with Iran. Americans are accused of bad relation with Turkey. So who left? And the Russians, unlike the Americans, are loyal to their allies. The Russians want, and this is point number three, a Middle Eastern presence. It's not only Syria. It's the ports and the military airfields that with their military power, they can be securing at least the eastern part of the Mediterranean, which lead to the Black Sea and to Russia, what used to be Ukraine and is Russia now. There is another issue that you have to pay attention to, and this is the internal situation in Russia. Russia economy is deteriorating due to low oil price and due to the sanctions. And what is a better way to divert the people's attention from their hardship than give them some patriotism thinking of what Russia is doing and the Russian military is fighting And the Russians support Putin in an impressive approval rate. Then saving Assad, because the turning point is not after the chemical weapon episode of 2013. The turning point of Russian coming to Syria is in the September 2015, when Assad was on a verge of defeat, when the opposition was on the way to Latakia, which is the heart of the Alawite area. And then Putin came to save Assad. Last but not least, don't forget the formal Russian excuse. They came to fight ISIS, Daesh. But any expert who is looking at the targets of the Russian Air Force, Daesh is not there at the top of the list. It's on the bottom of the list. So I think Igor put it right on Russians seeing America disengage from the Middle East, pivoting to Asia or to nowhere, and this vacuum brought the Russians back to the Middle East. What the Russians have achieved? I must commend them, the Russians, because they have achieved most of their goals. They are a global player again, waiting for the deal to be offered. They are loyal to their allies. They have military presence in the Mediterranean. Public relation domestically, I don't know, Igor is more of an expert than me. Assad was saved, and Daesh was attacked by everybody, the Americans, the Russians, the Turks, the Kurds, but it's not the Russian main goal. I must also commend the Russians for their operational art. You know, the usual saying in the West, we cannot solve this problem militarily. The Russians show us that maybe they don't solve the problem militarily, but using military instruments with other diplomatic instruments is a menu that you have to exercise smartly after thinking on how much, where, to what objective. And the Russian basically with a modest investment, with limited risks, achieved the goal. Unfortunately, the Russians put an equation that I personally don't like, and I'm not representing the Israeli government here. They basically left us with the dilemma to choose between Assad and Daesh, because most of their attack is on the secular, moderate Sunni opposition to Assad. And by weakening it and bombing it, they left us with, okay, choose. Do you want Daesh or Assad? Which I personally don't want both of them. Next point. Syria is a tragedy. It's a human tragedy. It's a humanitarian crisis of the 21st century. Numbers cannot even describe what is going there. 500,000 people killed. And don't mistake, 95% of them were killed by Assad and his allies. Yes, ISIS killing them in a more pathetic and public relation kind of killing. But 95% of the killed people are killed by Assad and his allies. And Russia is part of it, unfortunately. And this tragedy of 500,000 killed, 2 million wounded, 11 million refugees, 5 million in Jordan, Turkey, Lebanon, and 6 million domestically. This is a tragedy. And I think the Russians should think about it from time to time. I also ask my Russian friends why they choose the Shia over the Sunnis in the Middle East. Because they used to be friends of the Sunnis, of Egypt, as the main of Libya. In Iraq there was a Sunni leader. Somehow they choose Iran, Hezbollah, and the Alawite in Syria. Those who don't know, this is a minority in the Arab world, a small minority. To the credit of the Russians, their answer to me is, look, we keep good relations with everybody. Look, we are with the Turks and with the Iranians, with the Kurds and with the Sunnis, with the Shia and with the Israelis and with the Palestinians. I think that for the long run, it will backfire, but we'll see. Where Israel is standing. Some people think that Israel is pivoting from the US to Russia. This is a huge mistake, a huge mistake. Yes, our prime minister and the American president in the last 8 years were not in a good state of relation. There was no trust there. And Putin was very friendly to Netanyahu. But if you look at the records of the Russian voting in the UN, never with Israel, always with the Palestinians, with the Arabs. If you see who is giving Israel $3 billion military and defense aid, it's coming from Washington, not from Moscow. So Israel cannot pivot to Russia. We have a very serious ally, which is the United States of America. There is some family disagreements, but basically we are going together. Last, we have very good coordination on the tactical level with the Russians. Deconfliction is essential. We don't want to make the mistakes that the Turks have done. The Russians are flying very close to our borders, sometimes across the borders. We are flying from time to time in Syria. And we are, there was a mechanism that was established and it's working very well. But once again, we don't have to make the mistake. The fact that tactically we are coordinating to avoid collision is not to say that strategically what Russia is doing in Syria is against Israel's interest. They are helping not so much Assad, but the Iranians and Hezbollah, which is our worst enemies, to become stronger, closer to our border. And this is something that Prime Minister Netanyahu and President Putin should talk about.
Thank you very much indeed. So we have about 40 minutes or so for Q&A, and I'm going to start things off by maybe just asking Igor to come back on the two implicit points of criticism from Amos. I think both of you were fairly agreed that Russia had been successful in pursuing and meeting its short-term strategic interests, but would like to say something about the difficulties that could arise in respect to relations with the Sunni world for Russia over the long term, and then this point that Amos just made about the corollary effect of Russian action being to strengthen those who are hostile to Israel in the region.
I sometimes think that Putin is the grandson of Palmerston. Never eternal friendship, always eternal interest. That's what he's doing. And from this point of view, step by step, he shows himself a beautiful tactician. From my personal point of view, as well as the Amos, if I understand him, strategy, huge question mark, and probably the dead end. But I guess he figures out, listen, everybody's so cynical and pragmatic in the world. I have only about two 20, 30 years to live and only about 10, 15 years of political life. We'll see. We'll meddle through. This is my impression of what he's doing, because otherwise, to have this powder keg in Chechnya, Dagestan, and all of these Caucasian republics of ours, who are predominantly Sunni, and to talk to Saudis on price oil, having definite interest in supporting Sunnis, and then running to Shia for the tactical reason of getting to the Mediterranean first, securing a naval base and an air force base on Syrian coast, and then a whimsical project of circumventing Western sanctions. If, for example, tomorrow they say, we sanction your oil and gas because this is your only source of income, or 70% of your income. And then he says, okay, then from Caspian, using my good relationship with Iran and Iraq, part of it, and Kurds, I bring my pipeline to Syria and I trade with the whole of the world and forget about your sanctions. That was one of the reasoning I heard from some of the people. I cannot claim that I'm an insider. So pragmatism and cynicism versus strategic thinking, here I cannot tell you, simply cannot tell you, where's this balance in this head. The difficulty and risk management in my country is that if in Israel you can talk about parties and Netanyahu, Lieberman and other connections, if in the United States you can count on the founding fathers' wisdom of dividing powers, in our situation, risk management is in the head of one person, and that's difficult, believe me. We think that we know this person, but it's still very, very mysterious how some of the decisions are being taken. Back to your question, first of all, this reliance on Sunni Shia divide, and plus they definitely brought Kurds into the equation, for sure, because there are talks with Kurds, there are high-level delegations of Kurds in Moscow. Kurds as the nation had a state only once, and it was on the territory of the Soviet Union. Kurds remember that. They are very thankful for that, and we know how to handle Kurds, because they were spread all over Azerbaijan, Armenia, and other republics of the Soviet Union, and some of them were quite impressive state officials in the Soviet Union. So my take is that there will be changes. If and when some people will offer Mr. Putin something in exchange for his very controversial situation and position now in Syria. But it's not only Syria, because talks with Palestinians, including Hamas, which officially is forbidden in Russia, but there are contacts, obviously. Iranian contacts with both sides, good guys and bad guys. That's very tricky business, and I don't know where it will end up strategically again. At the moment, he made his cards full of traps.
One more to be added soon. Yeah. Okay, who would like to make an intervention? If you could wait until the microphone reaches you, please, and then identify yourself for the benefit of the speaker. You here in the third row on my left. Well, first to catch my eye.
Thank you. Student of War Studies at Parvana War Studies, King's College London. You mentioned the PR victory that Russia's won by showing its loyalty to its allies, but it's as well as the backlash that's incurred by supporting Iran and Hezbollah. We've also seen Trump heavily criticize Obama's deal with Iran, Now, how does this impact the future of Russia's relations with, say, the Persian Gulf, who have been conspicuously absent during this presentation?
If we take this Iran deal, I guess the question is to me first, and then
yes,
Amos probably will correct me. If the question is that, how about the Iran deal and Trump's criticism, and that's being a core of many other issues in the area, if I understand correctly, the deal like P5 plus one cannot be dismantled by Trump like this. He cannot get us, he can get us out of TTIP and TTP. That's within his presidential competence. But he cannot dismantle easily Iran deal. It goes to the United Nations security. It goes to the United Nations resolution and all of that stuff. So from this point of view, there will be talks. And during these talks, if they see eye to eye, Trump and Putin, there will be some enticing things, I'm sure, for Americans and for Trump personally, on behalf of Russians, who always kept good relations with Iran. By the way, in principle, after the Second World War, Soviet Union and Russia, as a continuity of the Soviet Union on strategic issues, has a right for the whole of the northern Iran. Tomorrow we can step in, that's it, that's ours. We will never do that, but there are a lot of ties between different communities, and we have considerable influence and interest there. So I'm sure, I don't know, but I'm sure that Mr. Putin can offer some kind of a very tangible deals to the interest of the Americans in Iran. So if you talk about this, I think that some of the worries of Mr. Trump saying that they can get nuclear arms tomorrow under this deal, I think that the Russians can prove useful in this thing. There will be further contradictions in the positions, and that's why I told you that if Giuliani is the State Secretary tomorrow, if McCain is back in the inner circle of influential Americans, you will see that all of this rosy aspirations and optimism of Russians that, oh, now we have our own man in the White House, will vanish. And I'm sure that 70% of that will come true very, very soon, because the interests are the loggerheads, and in spite of the same kind of a value scale Trump and Putin seems to have, there will be some big issues on behalf of the American electorate, Congress and Senate, as well as the consolidated West, that will not allow that to happen.
But how would the Persian Gulf react to balancing between Iran and Syria, Russia and Israel? If you have America on one side that seems to be against Obama's policy towards Iran, and a Russia on one side that is supporting Iran, how does that?
So my feel is that, you know, talking to some people in Oman, in Qatar, they see that shale gas changed the relationship considerably. And if it was vital before, could you imagine that without shale gas and without this new independence, do you think any American president would meddle through in the Syrian case? There would have been ground operation, there would have been many other things. But at the moment, we see indifference, aloofness to the area, okay? And that's being confirmed by Sultan Qaboos and other knowledgeable people that, you know, we feel it, okay? We feel it. We talk to Russians about the pricing in OPEC, we talk about this, we talk about this, okay? So the world changed, including including due to I would say unprincipled position of the United States on a number of issues.
Amos?
Including complacency of the Western nations in EU on many issues on which they should stand tall, resolute, etc., etc., like in Ukraine. But they didn't.
I think very soon, President-elected Trump will see what many, many politicians have saw in the past, that governing is not campaigning. And what you have said in the campaign, sometimes our Prime Minister Sharon used to say, what you see from the Prime Minister office, you don't see when you are on the opposition. So I'm not sure he is going to implement all his promises, statements, especially that some of them are conflicting. He have said that, and they have said the other way around. So we'll have to see what kind of policy is adopting. It's too early to evaluate. We don't even know who is the team around him. And I'll give you the first example. He spoke a lot about the need to go back to America. Isolation, it's called. If John Bolton is the Secretary of State, this is the opposite, vis-a-vis Russia, vis-a-vis China, vis-a-vis all what John Bolton described as bad guys. So we don't know where this administration is going. In a way, interesting point that I've learned yesterday in the IISS, that there is a lot of similarity between Obama and Trump on the Middle East. Both of them are saying, we go home, we disengage. So we'll have to see. On the Iran deal, the Iran deal is not a treaty. He can easily abort it. So you don't have to go to the Congress and get two-thirds. But I think that he has enough on his plan. Crises. Syria, North Korea, South China Sea. Why putting another crisis that is not needed? Because the Iranian deal is not a good deal. It's a problematic deal. It's not a new Holocaust, as my prime minister will say. It's not deserve a second Nobel Prize, as some people in the State Department will say. It's a deal that in the short run, put us in a better situation than we have been a year ago. We are better off today. The Iranians are a year from the bomb and not 2 months from the bomb. However, it has two huge deficiencies. One, the long run. In 10, 15 years, the Iranians have a legitimacy to have a full-scale nuclear program, zero distance from the bomb. And this is not Bibi Netanyahu. This is President Obama saying. And it's cover only the nuclear issue. The rest of the Iranian millennium behavior, supporting terrorism, human rights, all the other problematic behavior of Iran is not dealt with this deal. And here is the change that Trump can make comparing to the Obama administration. The Obama administration was committed to the deal. He did everything that the deal will go forward. He closed his eyes to the rest of the Iranians' behavior and some violations and non-nuclear behavior and the ballistic missile tests that violate another UN Security Council resolution. So Trump have the chance here to say, I'm not taking it off the table because I have partners, P5 plus one. I don't want another crisis, but I will be very strict on the Iranians. I will not send my Secretary of State to convince the Europeans to make business with Iran. I will be tough on them, but I will keep the deal.
Thank you very much. You in the first row, please.
Good afternoon, Nazanin Ansari, Tehran, London. Regarding Russian presence in Syria, how effective was the Iranian demand to invite Russia to back them up because of the casualties that they were having and the losses in Syria? And how important has been Mr. Khamenei to Russia? And was he ever a student in Russia? And as far as Mr. Trump and Iran is concerned, there are voices in Iran, actually within the close to the Supreme Leader and the Revolutionary Guards, that are very happy for Mr. Obama, Mr. Trump to have been elected. They are hoping for more business deals with America. Do you think that there would be a time or a possibility that Mr. Trump would offer U.S. businesses or U.S. cooperation in return for a pullback on Iran's missile program? Thank you.
Igor.
On the importance of Khomeini, first of all, I don't know whether he ever was on the territory of Russian Federation. Second of all, I think that he is so controversial that for the Russian Muslims, that would be more of a liability than an asset. And I think that our special forces and intelligence knows about that. And I don't think that they played with him. They were Rafsanjani, some other people. I wouldn't put it past them, but not Khomeini. That's my nuts feeling. That's not information. As far as the Iranian influence to get us involved on the side of Syria, I think it was secondary or third or fourth rate or something like that, because what moved Russian leadership is Russian historical fixation on getting to the Mediterranean with the naval base and with the air force and massively getting the, you know, that the whole Russian ideology before the revolution, imperial past, and after was built up on a slogan which runs like this: Russia is the third Rome and there never be the fourth one. Meaning that after Constantinople fell down, Russians picked up the real Orthodox faith, and we are the guardians of this faith of the first Rome, and forget about everything. So that's why one of the purposes of Russian involvement in the Second World War was to get to Constantinople, to raise the Russian flag, and that's ours. We are the third Rome. So from this point of view, Khomeini and the Iranians, just forget about it in terms of Syria. But having said that, I should tell you that Iranians were, after they killed tens of thousands of communists after their Iranian revolution, to their party and all of that stuff, they were very loyal to the Soviet Union and to Russian Federation. And when in Russian Federation the Soviet Union collapsed, 91, 92, 93, 94. Turks, others were trying to get involved in all our mosques and everything else, propagating and building up. Iranians always were very cautious, reporting on all their contacts, getting no hatsy-tatsy business with the Russians on involvement. Very loyal and always very correct. From this point of view, the relationship was always much better in terms of trade and political trust than with anybody else in the region.
Thank you. Amos, the second question for you.
Now, I will help my friend Igor on the first one. Rafsanjani is gone. He's not in the business anymore. He used to be the president and now considered to be a reformist, a liberal. But he's not in the quarters of those who rule Iran. The name you have to remember is Soleimani. Soleimani is the commander of the IRGC and is all over the place. You can see him in Iraq, you can see him in Syria, you can see him in Lebanon, in Yemen. he is running the business of having Iran become the hegemon in the Middle East. He's a general, very brave, go with the troops on the ground. And one day he may replace Khamenei. So he is the guy to look at. What happened in Syria last fall, that Assad was on the verge of collapse. And the Iranians sent elite units to fight, but they have discovered what every army in the 21st century is discovering, that sending bodies back home is very, very difficult. Very difficult. So what they have done? They brought a Shia militia from Afghanistan, from Iraq, to fight instead of pure Iranian soldiers. And they brought the Russian Air Force. And the combination of that with Hezbollah changed the course of the fight. Mm-hmm. On a deal between the US and Iran, I think this is too far. I gave my arguments why Trump will not withdraw from the P5+1 agreement with Iran, but going to make deals with Iran, I think this is going too far.
Thank you. I think we'll try to cram in a number of questions in the next round, three or four of them, because time is running out. Gentleman here in the front row, just wait for the microphone to reach you. And if you can then hand it to the person immediately to your right.
Yes, sir. A member of the Institute. I just want to ask, you mentioned that Trump and Obama are very similar. Bear in mind what Obama has left in the Middle East. Is the world a safer place under Trump, bearing in mind we don't know what his appointments are, but we have an idea? Or is it, would it be better under Clinton, who would be much more likely to have faced up to Obama than Trump would be?
Okay. So we'll wrap this up. If you want to hand it to your right, please.
James Trump from Manchester, BC. Why do the operations in Syria and in eastern Ukraine leave the Russian
thank you. And then, yes, you please.
Hi, Sarah Diane from the Risk Advisory Group. I wondered if you could speak a little bit more about Israel and Hezbollah, and perhaps what Israel's red lines are for Hezbollah presence in Syria.
Thank you. And then behind you. Could you speak up a little bit, please? Thank you. No, but speak up and you will be louder.
Okay. Amar Nainar, Student of International Relations, Department of War Studies, College London. I have two short questions. Firstly, to Mr. Yergin specifically, what do you think about the recent rapprochement between Erdogan and Putin after what happened last year with Turkey and Russia, Russian jet shot down, when there's a rapprochement now, and especially when Mr. Putin visited Erdogan after the coup which happened. And to Mr. Gadlin, I would like to ask, there's this reluctance, among the Russians for any sort of a regime change in the Middle East. So would you like, do you buy that argument? That's what I think. Thank you.
Any final takers? Okay, if not, I think the first question about Trump or Clinton, which would be safer, is probably one that you can both take a stab at if you want. But the question on Russian military modernization, mm-hmm. Igor, perhaps you lead on that. Is the Hezbollah question, I think, for you, and the Erdogan-Putin one back to you. Mm-hmm. And then the last one, I think, was also
regime change. Yeah.
Regime change, yes, regime, but you can provide some perspective on that too. So why don't you start, Amos?
Okay, making prediction are very difficult, especially about the future, and even more difficult about hypothetical questions. So it was very interesting to answer this question before the election. I think it's now hypothetical. I think if we look to the to the past and try to project it into the future, America have two kind of presidents that were in the extreme. Obama, let's start from Bush 43. He, in a way, was very aggressive, very active, in a way overactive, and it's cost the American people $1 trillion, maybe $2 trillion, nobody knows exactly the number. Trillion is $1,000 billion. It's a lot of money. And thousands of people that were killed, and 10,000 that were wounded. And from strategical point of view, they haven't achieved the goal. 10 years of wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, and they haven't achieved the goal. So the American moved to the other policy, which is inaction. Do nothing. Disengage. And I already described the consequences, which are also very problematic. 500,000 killed, the Middle East is disintegrating, Russia and Iran and Hezbollah have a free license to kill whatever they want. So this is also a problematic. And I hoped that the next president will know how to find when to act and when not to act. This is the wisdom of being a strategist. This is the art of war and peace and diplomacy. Because I cannot think that somebody thinks that in the extreme it can reach everything. You know, only with military power, only by diplomacy. No, this is what I like about the Russians. In the way that they combine the tools that a state or a superpower has. I think Clinton would have been moving from where Obama was towards what she, as Secretary of State, and Gates and David Petraeus advised Obama. Because if you don't want to choose between ISIS and Assad, both of them should not rule Syria. And you're looking for a secular Sunni, because the Sunnis are the majority, secular Sunni, pragmatic state in Syria. This was a possibility in 2011, in 2012. The Russians were not there. ISIS were not there. So it was possible. Today, seems like even if FDR will come back to life, he cannot arrange it. So, and Trump, as I say, is a big, big, big question mark. We don't know where he's going. He can go to the isolation. He can go to a way of showing everybody that America is strong again. So we don't know. Israel and Hezbollah. The official Israeli position on Syria, which is not my personal one, is not to interfere, to be neutral. We are not interested. I think morally it's a mistake, and strategically it's a mistake. But the official Israeli position is we have red lines, and if somebody cross our red lines, we will react. So whenever somebody is firing from the Golan Heights towards Israel, we are firing back. And they have learned the lesson, it's quite a quiet border. Tranquility is there. The bad guys are fighting each other. ISIS against the Assad regime, Hezbollah against the other, and both of them are not firing at Israel. From time to time, there is a ricochet flying. The second red line is not to let Hezbollah and Iran have a new base in the Golan Heights. They are base, all of them are in Lebanon, well-based, with a lot of weapons. So don't let them open a second front in the Golan Heights. So Israel was active when they started to send terrorists and activities to the Golan Heights, and it was stopped. The message was understood. The last red line is advanced weapon. Unfortunately, very sophisticated, the best of the Russian air defense missiles is coming at the end to Hezbollah. The Russians are not sending it, but somehow through Syria, through Iran, a sophisticated weapon is going to Hezbollah. So when Israel understands that advanced missile SA-22, SA-17, the best Russian air defense, UAVs, Yachont, which is a land-to-sea amazing missile, is moving to Hezbollah. Somebody attacked these convoys. Nobody take responsibility, but it's done.
Thank you very much. Nico.
Syria and Ukrainian operation, what does that mean for the Russian army? Well, it's expensive, but not so expensive, fantastic maneuvers and exercise. In Syria, not a single jet was missed. In Syria, they tried this concept of A2AD, anti-air defense in area denial thing. They put S-300, S-400, one of the best anti-aircraft systems, which makes the area of 300 kilometers secure. And then they put their ballistic, whatever missiles and aircraft, and it's impenetrable. So you create an area which nobody, including United States, can hit without huge consequences, like massive ballistic missile replies. And that thing is now being tested in Syria and will be installed, my guess, in Kaliningrad area if Finland and Sweden joins NATO. And that's a great headache, insurmountable headache for example, Polish army. Ukrainian thing is even less costly, because what they do, they definitely support first and second parts of operation through special forces and intelligence officers, but which are hundreds, not thousands. And then they employ a very unique kind of people, lost generation, if you wish. After Vietnam, you had it in the United States, and we have it after Chechnya and after Afghan war. People, 40, 50, who can do nothing but shooting. They didn't find their place in the normal life. And whenever there is a cause, pro-Russian cause, any place, Serbia, Yugoslav crisis, Chechnya, wherever, they go, they're sort of private armies, and they do it for pleasure and for very little money. And some of those people, paradoxically, were the when we didn't have wars, were the permanent attenders and demonstrators against Putin downtown Moscow, because they hated capitalism, they hated the decline and then the collapse of the Soviet Union. They were that kind of villains who wanted to fight and didn't know what else to do. So from this point of view, this combination of guerrilla war and regular war through special forces is not very costly in Ukraine. But long term, existential conflict between two peoples who are supposed to be brothers, if not one nation, Ukrainians and Russians, that's terrible. So the sooner it's over, the better for both countries, the sooner it's for the Europe, Central and Eastern Europe, and and the world in the, as a whole. And I hope that Mr. Putin and his supporters understand that, because that will be for ages, and that will be much worse than the Yugo crisis.
Amos, do you just want to come in on this question of regime change to close us down?
Yeah. No, the business of regime change is a bad business, and everybody got out of it until after 2003. So the regime change from the external force is gone. It's gone. Nobody is trying now to change regime from the outside. The Russians are doing regime saving, which is another business, which I don't like, but I think what is happening in the Middle East is a regime change from the inside, from internal, domestic forces that are changing regime. This happened in Libya, in Egypt, in Yemen, Tunisia, Syria is not decided yet, Bahrain was an attempt. The real question for us, expert for the Middle East, is what next on the Arab Spring 2, because it's coming. The Arab Spring 1 haven't solved any problem, not the demography issue, not the poverty issue, not the dictatorship regimes that are not taking care of their people. If you look at Egypt today, it's very, very close to Egypt in 2011. You know, General Sisi took over, the Egyptian people supported him, not in election, but going to the street, and he have delivered for 2-3 years, but now it seems like the Saudis cut the money, and price of fuel go up, people are not happy. I don't know when Egypt will go to another turmoil. You should look at the Saudis. For many, many years, people have said, expert, that Saudi is unsustainable. And the Saudis were smart enough and rich enough to foil these predictions. But if you look at the problems that the Saudis are facing these days, low oil price, and the reservoir is going of $1 billion is going to be dry in 2 years, a war in Yemen, they have discovered that going to war sometimes look like a great thing. You know, the television, the defense minister is speaking, CNN is broadcasting the precise weapon, and then what, after 2 or 3 weeks? There is a third generation fighting for the crown. There is ISIS around. There is Iranian activity through the Shias in the east. So look at the Saudis. And if Egypt and Saudi going through a regime change, it's another Middle East once again.
Thank you very much. I think from the quality of that discussion, you can tell why the ISS were very pleased that Dr. Jurgens and General Yadlin are members of our council. And I'd like you to please join me in thanking them for the presentation today. Thank you very much.